Thank you all for your patience while we've been sorting out the technology, the logistics of what we are doing this morning, which is presenting a panel of pioneers of queer comics who are men. We didn't necessarily plan to have like a boy-girl pioneers panel, and we're also having a giant gay comics artists reunion in here, so everybody is welcome. Yesterday, we saw pioneers of queer comics who were women. Today, we are seeing more pioneers of queer comics, and we will see even more pioneers of queer comics. So we're doing a lot of pioneering today. The folks who are with us today are Kurt Erichsen, Gerard Donelan, Rupert Kinnard, and Howard Cruse. A couple of folks could not make it here, Rick Fiala and Larry Fuller, but I can tell you a little bit about them now, and I can show you some of Rick Fiala's artwork so you get a sense of what you would have seen. For starters, I would like you all to know about Larry Fuller. He sent us a bio, which was very kind of him to do, even though he could not make it. And I would like to at least try to have his work depicted for us, even if we can't hear from him. Yep. One moment. Got it. Here we go. So this is maybe more of Larry than you would have seen if you were here. It's larger than life.
Yeah, what you've got here is the PDF rather than the PowerPoint.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But let me just make sure I can view this whole thing. There we go. Good enough for improv. Larry Fuller sent us this bio in lieu of being able to be here. Larry Fuller was born in New Orleans in 1944, and now I'm going to switch to the first person, so imagine he is saying this. As long as I can remember, I've loved comics, starting with things like Nancy and Sluggo, Gasoline Alley, Terry and the Pirates, Henry, Popeye, Tarzan, Batman, etc., and everything in between. I moved to San Francisco at 13, left at 18 to join the U.S. Air Force, came back almost 6 years later. And the entire time I was away, I collected comics and wrote stories, never really thinking I would ever publish anything, and all very unlike what I eventually did publish. After my discharge, I became aware of underground comics, was inspired by some, and saw a whole lot of possibilities. One day in 1968, I went to Gary Arlington's, rest in peace, original comic book store. There I met a great deal of others involved in the comics and comics with an X scene, including my late great friend and collaborator, the artist Ray Horn, later also known as Wiley Spade. We hit it off instantly, being the first black comics artist either of us had ever met. In 1975, we created and published White Horror Funnies number one, meeting with moderate success. Somehow, we got the idea to publish a book for a gay audience, which led to the first issue of Gay Heartthrobs, said spelling being an obvious editorial oversight by yours truly. There's only one T instead of like T for heart and T for throbs, but you get the meaning. Over the next 17 or so years, I published several other titles, but only managed two more issues of Gay Heartthrobs, spelling corrected subsequently, both of which were graced by the presence of the great but ever self-effacing Mike Kuchar. One of my fondest memories is walking on Folsom Street one sunny afternoon, and two young men were approaching arm in arm, holding opposite ends of a comic book, and laughing like hell. They never noticed me, but as they walked by, I saw what they were reading. Gay Heartthrobs number one. What a blast. Like a secret reward or something. In retrospect, it was a good deal of fun, although not very profitable in the long run. This came to us from Larry Fuller on May 4th. So, also unable to be here, but generous enough to share his work with us so that you can get a sense of it, is Rick Fiala. And in this case, he has provided for us a little rehearsal of what we will be seeing from the other artists. Rick Fiala wrote for us. In the summer of 1976, the staff of a new monthly called Christopher Street was putting together the first issue. It was to be a short, sort of gay New Yorker, and that meant, among other things, that it would include single gagline cartoons. Chuck Ortlieb, the publisher and editor-in-chief of Christopher Street, had some ideas. He cut out cartoons from the New Yorker and other magazines and pasted his own typewritten gag lines under them. Since I was the art director of the magazine and none of us knew any cartoonists at the time, I tried my hand at the drawings. Chuck and I turned out to be a great team. Soon he was handing me a list of 12 to 15 gag lines without the accompanying art. I'd read a line and the image would often come to me immediately. The only problem we saw was that it looked bad for the magazine to have just one cartoonist, so I started to vary my drawing style and sign the cartoons with different names. Homosexuality and gay life were big media topics in the 70s. There were lots of theories of what causes homosexuality. We weren't all out to our friends and family at the time, but then some people were starting to recognize us. The hyper-masculine look of gay men in the 70s, short hair, mustache, bomber jacket, and jeans, was very much commented on. Who done it? And we had questions about whether monogamy was a natural state for gays. Or for some, not for others. But most of all, we were learning to thrive in one another's company. This comes to us from Rick Fiala, the accidental cartoonist. Okay, so now what you are actually here for is to hear from the cartoonists who are actually here, starting with Kurt Erichsen. Kurt Erichsen is the artist behind Murphy's Manor, a comic strip syndicated in local gay newspapers from 1980 to 2008, and received the Gay and Lesbian Press Association Awards in 1985 and 1988. His work also appeared in Gay Comics, the Meat Men books, half the book Between the Sheets with Bruce Billings, and illustrations for Instinct magazine. In 2002, his art received the Rotzler Award, and you can check out more of his work at kurterichsen.com or right now.
Thank you for that introduction. As the bio said, my work includes a syndicated comic strip, Murphy's Manor, and a swath of miscellaneous. When No Straight Lines came out last year, they put me in the retro section of the book. I find now that I'm not just retro, I'm a queer pioneer. In 1980, I never would have guessed that would be a badge of honor. In 1981, when I drew the first six Murphy's Manor strips on spec, I had to do some soul searching. Did I preserve my closet by using a pseudonym or sign my real name? Well, was I doing anything wrong by drawing these cartoons? Did I really have anything to hide? If I used a false name, what's that say about my gay pride, which after all is the point of the strip? Here we have the very first Murphy's Manor comic strip. Murph is pacing back and forth, expecting his new roommate. The door rings, and Jeff pops in. Hi, my name's Jeff. You must be Murphy. I'm just coming out. I want to try everything. Where's my room? Well, at least he's flexible. Speaking of technology. There we go. Murphy's Manor ran 1,183 weekly strips until 2008, and if you do the math, yes, I missed a few weeks in through there. Appropriately, in the very first and in the very last strip, Murph, or Jeff, rather, is the eternal party boy, looking for love and all of the stuff on the way. Murphy's Manor is really the cornerstone of my work, and I'm going to be dwelling on that in more detail in the queer humor panel next session. Here in the final Murphy's Manor strip, Jeff is at the bar with Sid and notes that he always understood that you can't be too rich, too thin, or too popular. Sid begs to differ. He says you can only never be too buff or too bitchy. What, is it okay to be rich? Some things are universal. My Gay Comics number one story was Saboteur, and I think that the way I made the connection there was an ad that ran in The Advocate, if memory serves, and somebody told me about it, so I wrote Howard a letter, and the rest is history. The story was called Saboteur, an autobiographical metaphor about a gay man getting a job in a homophobic city. It starts with the moral: being gay but assumed straight can be like being a spy. So the story is about a gay secret agent going undercover at a queer-bashing manufacturer. In the job screening process, our hero goes through a procedure where they measure how limp his wrist is to make sure they ain't hiring no homos. Which is not much of an exaggeration, and a couple of dialogue boxes of text are pretty much, quote, directly a real-life co-worker at the time who insisted that all queers should be lined up and shot. So, did I go to my boss to complain? One didn't do that in the 1970s. Maybe we should have, but we didn't. At least not in Toledo, Ohio, one didn't. Sparkle Spinsters was a continuing series that I did for Gay Comics, four stories at Gay Comics and one later at Meat Men. My idea for the concept I swiped from Gilbert Shelton's Freak Brothers, and the basis was three individuals, each based on real people, actually, who were, quote, into the lifestyle to the hilt. In Shelton's case, that was the drug culture. In my case, it was being gay. So the main characters from left to right are Duchess, who puts on airs of his own, and Vernon on the right, who camps up constantly, while Lee in the middle is the straight-acting one of the trio. Together, they pursue sex, but never with each other. In home movies, they decide to make the world's hottest, most literary porn film as a tool for seduction. Duchess gets into the role-playing, again, to the hilt, just like him. Page 4 of the strip makes the strip memorable, at least for me. The border tells the story of this movie that they're making around the edge of the page while the story continues in the middle. The final Sparkle Spinster story, which ran in Meat Men, came from this inspiration. The publisher, Winston Leyland, told me that he left me out of the S&M book of Meat Men because he didn't think that I could do an S&M story. So, of course, I had to try it. And so was born Little Red Riding Crop. One time I gave a presentation that included this story. I got a question from a young man in the audience. What's a riding crop? Well, come here, little boy, and I'll further your education. Honeymoon only 3 pages long, was one of my favorites. This was from one of the later issues, one of the Andy Mangels issues of Gay Comics. Certainly the most over-researched story I've ever done. I read a book on naming pets. I named a book on pet psychology. Between the two, they gave me the name of the character, Honeymoon, and suggested the plot. The gag is the urban legend about gays who supposedly use gerbils for dildos. I wrote a story about a gay couple who happened to be gerbils and had a pet human. The gerbils looked disturbingly like Pat Buchanan and Jerry Falwell. Honeymoon, their pet human, is very dog-like, so naturally he doesn't wear any clothes. When complete, this story fell victim to censorship. It seems that the Canadian government would not allow a drawing of a naked person over the border. So if I wanted to have the story published, and there were no other alternatives at the time, I had to comply and put pants on Honeymoon. Of course, I did so with a Canadian maple leaf just to say hello to the nice people at the border. These changes I did not make on the original artwork. The original artwork, he's still naked. This was all done on stats. Duchess of the Sparkle Spinsters was featured in a book called Under the Covers, which was half Bruce Billings and half me. I think my favorite gag of the story is the frame in which the story takes place, with Duchess telling a bedtime story to his three nephews who pop up literally out of nowhere. I figured that if Donald and Daisy Duck, Mickey and Minnie Mouse, even Popeye the Sailor and Woody Woodpecker all have matching sets of nephews or nieces, why not the Duchess? By the way, I never named them in the script, but their names respectively are Prissy, Sissy, and Kissy. Duchess tells them the story of his high school days in which he made homosexuality fashionable and performed unmentionable acts on the captain of the football team in the middle of the football field during halftime. He was a queer as queer. And in the end, it returns to the frame. Gosh, Uncle Duchess, he's amazing. Do you suppose all that really happened? Of course not. Uncle Duchess is an artist. One Step at a Time was a gay comic story that didn't happen for the reason that the editor, namely the guy on the end there, rejected it. He thought it was a borderline case, but in the end, the answer was no. My inspiration was the great annual gay picnic in Detroit. Allegedly, I never went. It featured widespread nudity and had hot sex in the bushes. I pondered, how in the world did they get away with it? Where's the purity of our politics as a serious cause? Howard thought I took on too many issues. My point isn't to bitch about the story being rejected. It's what Howard did next. He redrew the entire story in thumbnail, hammered out a 12-page letter discussing my 6-page comic strip, and proposed a collaboration. So is that insane or what? Howard, do you ever sleep? I've got plenty of editor stories, but no other editor would take that kind of effort on a junior cartoonist. So thank you, Howard, but my answer was no. Maybe you were right in everything you said, but the result would have been a Howard Cruse story, not a Kurt Erichsen story, so it sits in our respective filing cabinets. Another favorite story of mine was from Meet Men, was called Link Up, favorite because of the characters. It started with a gimmick, and that gimmick was how could a character have sex using all the new technological outlets, email, chat rooms, webcams, fax, 3D printers, to have sex while never actually meeting the person he was having sex with? And my puzzle was how to construct a story where that happens, under what circumstances. And the answer I came up with was a young guy, post-high school, by the name of Gary, who was kind of a loser, and who can't hold down a job because he keeps getting caught having sex at work. He lives at home with his parents who know he's gay and will never let him forget what a loser he is. And to control his sexual urges hold him virtually a prisoner. His dad even sniffs Gary's used Kleenex to see if he's masturbating. So what's a young man to do? I can't hold it. Oh God, oh God, oh God. Out the window. Later in the story, Gary's dad complains about the bird shit all over the top of his car. I wanted to talk just a little bit about money. It's said that to be a successful artist, you have to be a successful businessman, and that's probably true, and I confess to being mediocre in that area. I sold Murphy's Manor to local papers by sending flyers and letters. Initial reaction in 1981 was very good, about 15 papers signed up, but less than half ended up actually paying the bill when I sent it in. Over the next 27 years, invoice chasing plagued me the whole time. Gradually, most of the fly-by-night rags went under and papers became more professional. They're certainly slicker today than they were back then. And I apologize for picking on the Seattle Gay News. They were one of many. I tried everything I could think of in order to improve collections. I even tried getting cute with my invoices. It didn't really help. I charged at first less than $10 per cartoon, and for most of the run between $10 and $20 per cartoon for Murphy's Manor. Gay Comics and Meat Men paid $30, $35, something like that, for script, pencils, inks, and lettering. And if you do the math on that, it comes to far less than minimum wage. But I guess my point is that I don't expect to get rich as a cartoonist, but I would like something, and nothing equals a truer form of sincerity than a check. Getting a like on Facebook is cute, but it's just not the same as a check on paper. Murph, over its lifetime, was in about 70 papers. That's over 28 years, not all at once, unfortunately. Usually about 5 to 8 at a time. Some carried the strip for a few months and then didn't pay their bill, so I dropped them. But others ran the strip for years. Let me tell you about the last time I spoke to my main angel, Bill Watson of the Miami Weekly News, who ran Murphy's Manor for 25 years. With creditors banging at the door and the paper about to die, he remembered his freelancers. I've only got so much money left, and I can either let the bank have it or I can give it to a cartoonist that I owe for comic strips. Take this check and run, do not walk, to the bank. In a couple of days, it'll be no good. Bless you, Bill Watson, wherever you are today. To this day, we still call our house Murphy's Manor with this reason. The comic strip, over its lifetime, brought in enough money to pay the principal on the mortgage, which is not bad, but don't be too impressed. Toledo has what is charitably called an affordable housing market, and that took 28 years. But it did bring in a significant amount of money, even though it didn't exactly get rich on it. And I do have a day job. But doing the money was a significant challenge of that strip. And you'll note that I number the comic strips. That was an administrative technique to make sure that I knew what strip I'd sent to whom and whether they had paid for each individual strip or not. Should I send number 852 this month? Wait, I spent number 852 last month. And because nothing pisses off an editor more than sending him a strip in April that you already sent him in March. So should a gay artist be paid for his work, or should his art be a donation to the cause? I happen to think even an artist deserves to eat. Glib Talk was a single panel cartoon that I did 67 panels for from 2000 to 2006. It had multiple lives that changed the nature of the panel depending upon who was publishing it. It started out as a syndicated political cartoon, and here we have Prissy, Sissy, and Kissy again, this time following the legal profession. It later was picked up by More Light, the gay Presbyterian newsletter, and so I turned to ecclesiastical topics, And here we have a cartoon about the very temporary Bishop of Reading who was gay and his victimization. And finally ended up with the Dallas Voice, where I had a great editor to work with and suggested a lot of the ideas. Very, very good partnership there. In the early 2000s, I had a two-year gig with Instinct magazine. The cartoons were mostly the editor's conception, but he had a good imagination, and I had no trouble working with that. I illustrated pages sponsored by advertisers. One year it was a financial advisor, and the second year a medical advisor, medical supplier. Beyond my professional gay work, I've drawn a lot of other cartoons. I've been active in comics and science fiction fandom since about 1970, producing fanzine work, some of it with a distinctly gay overtone. And I'd like to thank you for your attention. We got one more here. Two more. There we go. Thanks for listening.
Wonderful. Thank you, Kurt. So up next is Gerard Donelan. My apologies for doing names wrong. You'd think after, 2 years of working on this and be solid, but this is why it is important to know people in person.
Okay. Is this mic on? Can you hear me? Yeah?
Let me do a brief introduction. Gerard Donelan began a 15-year run in The Advocate in 1977, eventually entering into erotica for Advocate Men. His work also appeared in two Donelan collections and in Frontiers, Gunner, Meat Men series, and as t-shirts, rubber stamps, greeting cards, and in the Baseball Hall of Fame at Cooperstown. Nice.
Hi. This particular cartoon I did for the cover of Gay Comics, number 7. It's actually the black and white version of the eventual cover picture. And this is actually my mom and dad in it. This, however, is not dad's reaction to my announcement that I was gay. But mom did, in fact, say, "I thought you were just a sensitive boy." A story that goes along with this, my brother Tim, who loves comic books, collects all kinds of comic books, was in a bookstore looking at everything. He looks at everything and collects all kinds of weird things. And he said, I suddenly stopped and went, "Oh my God, that's my living room." He recognized the house and mom and dad in the cover and had to buy it. And he's been collecting all my stuff since then. And go on to the next one. Okay. Is this number 2? No. This is 3. Okay. Yes. Names Project. I worked on the Names Project just at the beginning of it quite a bit and did posters and all with them. And it gave us a real focus for the grief during that frightening period in the beginning. But it also gave us a chance to share memories, even with strangers, especially at the displays of the quilt. And it helped us all validate all of our relationships. But I wanted to show the kind of humor that we saw in Washington when we spread the quilt out and people were able to make jokes and laugh and remember all the good times. That's what this one was about. And number 3. This actually is my husband and me. He's on the bed. And I just wanted to look at our lives. The reason I started doing the cartoons is I wanted us to see ourselves as everyday people as opposed to gay guys out for sex. And this is when Chris and I were early on together. And he actually did try to make me keep my closet straight. And that's not going to happen. And he's the one sitting on the bed, the neat guy, and still is. Okay, number four. Yeah, do you remember when they decided we had disposable income? So, you know, we could do anything we wanted, and they would suddenly advertise to the gay community. I found that very interesting, thinking that just because we're gay, we had more money than straight people did. Not necessarily. Some of us were working jobs and being cartoonists, making almost no money at all. Okay, this is a black and white version of one I did for the Advocate Men when I took that foray into porn. Yes, I did do porn, but I actually, when Robert McQueen and Dennis Forbes called me and asked me, they said they wanted to do a men's magazine, and they asked me if I would be willing to do pornographic cartoons, sexy things. And I was not really comfortable with that. That's not where I was trying to go with my cartoons. I actually called my dad, who was an editorial cartoonist back in Plymouth, Mass. And I told him, I got this call. They want me to do, wait a minute, Dad, do you remember the Playboy cartoons? You know, full page, full color kind of thing? Yeah. He said, well, they want me to do that, but for a men's magazine. Oh. And I told him how much they were going to pay me for a page. He said, do it. So I ended up doing that for about 8 years. But this is one of them. And this particular image actually came to me on a subway ride. I was in San Francisco on my way home from work, I believe. And there were two guys behind me. I was sitting next to this very nice older lady. And they were talking very loudly, and one of them actually used the phrase, he tried to fuck my brains out. And this image came into my head, and I gave this huge laugh. And I had to go in and draw it. But I had to apologize to the poor woman next to me, because she thought I was crazy. But that image came full blown. I did color versions for Advocate Men, and then redid them in black and white to go into the Meat Men series, which we did a whole bunch of. Number six. Okay, gay my ass, we're lesbians. Do you remember the period when lesbians didn't like that gay parade thing and all of that? I just thought it was kind of weird because everybody seemed, no. But this was my attempt to make it kind of funny. But that's why we ended up with our alphabet community, right? And we're all part of the same group. And number seven. Okay, I was turning 40 when I did this one, getting a little bit older. Can you read that clearly? At 40, I was beginning to notice the invisibility or sort of invisibility of older men in the gay community in some areas. Luckily, not in San Francisco, where I was at the time. But it just seemed rather strange. And it was odd going through that transition of suddenly being much more careful than we had been before. And then as you get older, you don't have the opportunities to not be careful. Number eight. I always try to talk to younger gay people to tell them what happened before. You know, as I was growing up, you know, I thought the whole gay thing was absolutely brand new because I came out in 1970, you know, right after Stonewall. And I think it's important that we all understand what everybody else did before us so that they can appreciate what they have now. This whole idea of getting married was even unthinkable at one point in my life. And now it's already happened. So that's my tribute to the drag queens of Stonewall. And number 9. You know, at one point you had to have a gym membership or you couldn't call yourself a gay man. It was pretty amazing, and your pickup lines changed from what's your sign, or do you come here often, or is this your first time, to where do you work out? That's how you started a conversation. But gym bunnies were really fun to look at a lot. And number 10. This one, this popped into my head for Coming Out Day. Do you remember when they started that? I've forgotten what day it was, October 12th?
Something like that.
Yeah, was National Coming Out Day. And I thought, can you do cards for that? But so I came up with this idea for that particular day. And I actually got a letter from one of Barry Manilow's assistants. And he wanted to buy this cartoon. And stupidly, I wrote back and said, I'm sorry, but I'm not selling my originals at this time. What an idiot, huh? I should have done it. It would have made a better story, but that's no fun. And number 11. This is one of very few panels, multiple panel cartoons that I've done. I've done a couple of short stories and a few of these panels, but not too many. For some reason, I like that single gag line thing a lot. This I was just thinking about gaydar. To me, it was sort of like being a betazoid, like Deanna Troi on Star Trek. A little bit, but it doesn't work all the time. Why? I couldn't figure that out. You know, sometimes the vibes are just really weird. And they cut off, like, at a certain age for me. If you're, you know, like, under 24, I can't tell anymore. Now the number 12. As we became couples and started raising children, I wondered what it was going to be like when the kids came out either straight or gay and how you work. So this idea is, am I upset or am I envious that the child's fallen in love? But now there's, you know, big celebrations of gay family weeks at P-Town. I don't know if it's happening in other areas of the country, but I'm sure it is. And that's another thing that we never expected to happen. This one, number 13. I was at the advocate office one day, and I was asked by a woman who was there why I didn't do lesbian cartoons. I'm not a lesbian, I said. And she kind of just stopped and looked at me and said, do you think we're really that different? And I thought, oh, well, no, I guess not. We have sort of the same problems and all. So then I tried to get into that and incorporate lesbians in my gags more often. And this was one of my favorites. I actually knew someone who said that. And number 14. This is, what's the guy going on from? Oh, yeah. Have you ever been with somebody who like stopped before you got to the main event sort of thing in sex? It's the phone industry was sex thing was really, really big when I did this cartoon. And it just seemed kind of odd to me without having anybody else with you. And this last one, I thought was kind of appropriate now since we have so many gay athletes on the scene that we never expected to see out. And that's the end of my thing.
Rupert Kinnard, our next artist, is best known for BB and the Diva. BB and the Diva, a collection of cathartic comics, was published in 1992. The strip created the oldest continuing African-American gay and lesbian characters in the country and is archived at the San Francisco Cartoon Art Museum. Kinnard is also a graphic designer who describes himself as a sub-underground, under the underground. Political cartoonist, exploring the dynamics of racism, homophobia, classism, sexism, ageism, and the experience of being less abled. Rupert Kinnard.
Well, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I have to say I'm very honored to be here and to be here among the other cartoonists here. When I was invited to be a part of this panel, I decided that what I wanted to do was use it as a way to embrace the career that I've had as a cartoonist. Just by creating the characters that I created in 1977, I created the Brown Bomber in 77 and Diva in, I think it was like 81. And just by virtue of having created those characters, I've experienced so much that I really thought that I really wanted to kind of share that journey with you guys. A couple of last year, I was invited to Portland State University to speak about my cartoons and my career. And there was a young African-American man, and his name was Javen Green. And he was chosen to introduce me before I spoke. And it was a very humbling experience because Javen had come across a book of my comics when he lived in the Bay Area. And he was very forthcoming in telling me that as a young African-American gay man, to have come across that collection of comics really meant a lot to him. And what that meant to me is that we have no idea of how far spread our work can go. So that was very, very special for me. And so within my work, I've always thought that what I wanted to do was represent what I considered a kind of unique position in the gay male world of cartoons, because I was African American, so I really wanted to kind of focus on what that perspective might be. So these are my characters, my claim to fame. I'm not going to read it all, but it was very much fun creating the Brown Bomber and infusing him with some of the things that I love. So as a superhero, combination superhero fairy, it was really important to me to come up with some kind of weakness for him. And so my great love in the world is the Temptation singing My Girl. And my favorite dessert is sweet potato pie. So my thought was that here's the Brown Bomber, this great superhero, but he gets stopped in his tracks if he hears the song My Girl, specifically by the Temptations, not anybody else. And he can be, he can also be stopped by the smell of sweet potato pie. And then there's Diva, who, as I said, I created a number of years later. And I really enjoyed creating her because it was like a yin and yang situation between her and the Brown Bomber. The Brown Bomber was considered very innocent and didn't know very much about the world, and the Diva was just the opposite of that. I grew up in Chicago, and I was very, very into superhero comics. Initially DC Comics, which is Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, and then eventually graduated into Marvel Comics, Spider-Man, Daredevil, Fantastic Four. And I started drawing those characters, and then at some point I started creating my own characters. And at a certain point I realized, why am I drawing white superheroes? I'm from a black community. I wanted to start creating characters that reflected the community that I lived in. So I created Superbad, and Superbad was largely based on my love of Muhammad Ali. I wasn't into boxing, but I was really into Muhammad Ali's persona as constantly saying he was the greatest. That was really important for me as a young man in this culture where so many of the messages I was getting as an African American was that I was less than a man. So Superbad was kind of my take on a black Captain America. He was very violent and very revolutionary, and I loved him. But I really feel as if the pendulum swung for me, and I didn't want to be as angry as I was during a certain period. So in the, there's something about Joe Louis as a hero for African Americans during the 30s and 40s. And it was really interesting to me that I kind of used another boxer to kind of represent this newest superhero. So the Brown Bomber had more in common with, say, Martin Luther King than he did with Malcolm X. So during that period, I was able to meet Stan Lee, and he flipped through one of my sketchbooks. Stan Lee is the creator of Spider-Man Fantastic Four. So that was a really big lift for me in terms of just pursuing my drawing. So I eventually graduated from high school, lived on my own for 2 years, and then attended Cornell College. And during the summer of my first year in college, when I was in Chicago for summer break, is when I created the Brown Bomber. And when I came back to school, I was offered a spot on the school's editorial page to do my comic. And interestingly enough, the first few comics were one-panel comics. And I couldn't get the hang of the one-panel comics. I felt like I needed four panels to kind of, you know, create what I wanted to say. So this comic really represented the fact that the Brown Bomber was in my school newspaper for 2 years on the editorial page. He became kind of a mascot around the campus. And at one point, the African American students wanted to raise money for a scholarship fund. So we created 300 Brown Bomber t-shirts. And so faculty, administrators, students all bought these t-shirts. It was a huge success. And right after all the t-shirts were sold, I had the Brown Bomber come out as a gay character. So it was really exciting. All of these people were walking around campus with their Brown Bomber shirts, and I felt like it was my little subversive action to kind of pursue my agenda. So once I graduated from Cornell in 79 and I moved to Portland, I was part of the group of people who created Portland's premier lesbian and gay publication, Just Out. And during that period is when I created Diva Touche Flambe. And that was really an exciting period for me. And I just really, really enjoyed creating scenarios between the Brown Bomber and Diva with the idea that they really, really commented on a lot of things that were happening in the media and things that were happening in the city of Portland. This is actually, this cartoon really does represent the political slant of what I was trying to do. Specifically, as an African-American in the gay community, there was this feeling, even among women, that there were these gay, white gay male leaders who you got the sense that all they were trying to work towards was getting freedoms for gay men. Women didn't feel like they were included. People of color didn't feel like they were included in the agenda. So once again, where there were all of these gay male cartoonists with their focus, I wanted my focus to be some kind of critique of that community, the things that I thought that we really needed to work on. And during this period, all of these books here really represent really great influences for me at that time. Definitely Donelan, absolutely Howard. I was familiar with Kirk's work through Meat Men, the collection of gay male comics. And I have to mention Linda Berry and Alison Bechdel. Those were people who really influenced me. And during the time I lived in Portland, I got a chance to meet John Callahan. I don't know if many of you know John Callahan, incredibly cutting-edge cartoonist who was a quadriplegic, and he did these scathing cartoons about the way handicapped people were treated. And at this time when I met him, I was totally able-bodied. It wasn't until years later when I was in a car accident and became a paraplegic, we ran into each other, and it was really kind of surreal because he knew me as an able-bodied cartoonist, and then we ended up in the same boat. I ended up moving to the Bay Area in 1986. And that was an explosion of creativity for me because I started veering a little bit away from cartooning and doing more graphic design. So I was art director for a couple of publications in the Bay Area. But once again, I wanted to kind of use a black gay sensibility in my cartoon strips to really separate them from other strips. And nothing pisses black people off more than black people being referred to as the black white something. And it's just kind of this phenomenon that I wanted to share with the community to basically say, don't do that anymore. This is another example of what my political approach was in my strip. And this had to do with being upset with people considering Black History Month only a month for black people. So I had created these characters to go along with the Brown Bomber and Diva, Ray and Kay Sadia. And then they had a son named Gaylord, and they called him Gay Sadia. And the idea was that the Sadias let the Brown Bomber and Diva babysit their infant child once. And after that, their child was radicalized to the hilt. And that was one of the issues of Meat Men that Cathartic Comics was featured in for a couple of volumes. And I thought that I really wanted to make a shout out to Winston Leyland because as we've been celebrating gay comics and the collection of the comic books, gay comics, Winston Leyland through the Meat Men series was a showcase, I think, for a lot of us gay male artists. And I would say that being in Meat Men, it gave us all exposure around the world at least for me. I worked for the San Francisco Sentinel during this period, and they did this really wonderful article on the origins of the Brown Bomber and Diva, and that was a real highlight for me. But after I worked for that paper, I became art director of SF Weekly, and I love presenting this cover because it took me as an artist who didn't want to draw white superheroes anymore. It took me back to the old days, and this was during the time that the first Batman movie was released, and as art director, I did the illustration for the cover. This is my book that was published in 92, BB and the Diva, total highlight of my life. And the characters were also featured in Gay, Young, and Proud. And original cartoon strips of BB and the Diva are part of the Cartoon Art Museum in San Francisco as part of their permanent collection. And so this is really a page that represents all these different honors. And as you see, being with my pals, Allison, the late Chris Kovic, and I don't, that fellow's name, this guy here. This is a strip that I really feel represents the kind of evolution of my art style. There was this really interesting chemically treated paper where if you use, there were two clear liquids. If you use one liquid and you brushed it over a certain part of the board, you'd get this one pattern. If you use the other liquid, you got another pattern. I thought this, I really enjoyed the strip a lot, but I also like this as representing that technique. And after I left SF Weekly, I became art director of Outlook magazine, which was a really important queer journal during the time. After living in the Bay Area for 7 years and accomplishing all that I wanted to accomplish, I moved back to Portland. Once I moved back to Portland, it was really wonderful being invited to Oberlin for their cartoonist conference. And I was contacted by someone in the Bay Area who was putting together a live theatrical production, a storyline that featured his favorite cartoon strips. And he really enjoyed BB and the Diva. And it was such a thrill for me to travel from Portland back to the Bay Area and watch these people portray the Brown Bomber and Diva on stage. So that was a production called Out of the Inkwell. And the comic was also featured in the book Queer Facts. And I didn't know anything about this until one day I Googled myself and it said that the strip was in this collection, and that was pretty fun. In 1996, I traveled from Portland to Mississippi for my grandmother's funeral. And the day after my grandmother's funeral, I was on a two-lane road, and someone was veering towards my lane. And to avoid the car, I steered and went into a ditch, and I became paraplegic. I eventually made it back to Portland, where all of my friends and my community surrounded me and my partner. And I never had any opportunity to feel any kind of sadness or pain or anything because the love that I felt from my community was incredible. Once I ended up being able to make it back to work, I received a package in the mail, and it was from Allison Bechtel. And she wanted to send me a get well card. And she wanted to send the card around the country to allow other artists to be a part of that card. And it became so big that she decided to ask artists to just draw on a panel and send all the panels to her. And she would collect them and send them to me. And so this is the card that was sent. And it is like one of the greatest things. If you could stretch that out. Howard's a part of this display, as is Donelan. And the reason, I've already showed this to in one panel, but one of the reasons I really wanted to bring it, it really does have to do with one of the things that I've really enjoyed about the conference, and the fact that, you know, we are such a wonderful community, and I'm just so proud to be here and to be with a community that embraced me and my partner at such a time of need. Thanks, Howard. So this is the final panel. For the last 15 years, I've been, more than 15 years, literally, I've been working on what is called the Life Capsule Project. And the whole idea of this project is to just bring together all of these different elements of my life, all of these challenges and adventures. And it's, I just really, really am in the process of wanting to get the book published. I got this copy, thanks. This copy was printed on demand. And it's the first time I've actually held it in my hands. And the thing that's unique about it is it's considered kind of a graphic memoir, timeline, time capsule, scrapbook, photo album. It's really what it is. And so there's a lot about being in the conference that has really given me a lot of energy to go forth with getting it out there. So I just once again want to thank the committee that was involved in getting me here. So thanks.
How I remember it.
I have to work on pulling it together. Did you see your panel?
No, I didn't see it.
Shall I move ahead? At the time that I was asked to send some slides, I hadn't yet decided what I was going to do with my keynote. And as it turns out, you know, there's a lot of the stuff that you're about to see that was already talked about for those of you who saw the keynote last night, so I'm going to try not to dwell too much over repetitive material. But the point of this slide was to give an idea of what was going on while I was in Alabama and was aware of the gay movement gaining steam elsewhere. I saw there was an issue of Rolling Stone that had an article by John Reed, who we now know is, who is it? I've gone blank on his name, Andrew Tobias. But at the time he wrote under the name of John Reed, and he wrote this extremely influential, important book called The Best Little Boy in the World, which was one of the handful of books that talked about what everyday life of everyday gay people was like and what it was like to be in the closet and stuff like that. And he also wrote this article for the Village Voice called The Best Little Gay Newspaper in the World, in which he wrote about The Advocate, which I didn't know about until then. And so I subscribed down in Birmingham and became aware that there was this tabloid at the time publication, The Advocate. And, you know, in the background of my experience at that time was a few years before that I had had my experience of walking up to the Stonewall riots on LSD, and that stuck in my mind as an unusual experience. But meanwhile, this is I really look goofy in this picture, but this was a picture taken while I was working at the WBMG television station in Birmingham, and it's also when I, early in my relationship with Don Higdon, which was very transformative for me in terms of wanting, I had my first experience of feeling, really healthy about being gay. I think in Birmingham, the gay community that I encountered when I came out in roughly, I guess, 1964, it was very much sort of like the one in Stuck Rubber Baby. It was exciting. It was a community center. It was a welcoming group, particularly welcomed 21-year-old boys who were hot to trot. But anyway, but I think there was a lingering feeling that, we were all, somehow messed up, but we were showing that you could still have a happy life even if you were messed up. And I think that was the psychology. And it was only when I got together with Don and had these, real self-exploratory experiences that I realized that, there was nothing at all messed up about being gay. It was totally 100% healthy, and this was a catalyst for me to actually realize that I was angry over having been put through all the angst that I had as a teenager, and I wanted to somehow be part of the movement. Well, I mentioned this last night. This was my first foray into doing a gay cartoon for the Homosexual Counseling Journal, and that's Ralph Blair with Don and me. I had met Ralph during my brief period as a Penn State student. I didn't mention that last night because it's a side story, but I went to Penn State on a playwriting fellowship right out of college, but I really hated grad school. I just was not, I wrote a couple of short plays, but essentially I got a block because I just felt like I didn't have anything to write about. All of my plays were derivative, and I hadn't had enough life experience to write knowledgeably about life. And so I dropped out of Penn State after only one semester, went to New York. But at Penn State, I had met Ralph Blair. And so we remained friends, and then I became aware of him as a very important founder of the first counseling center for gay people. And I salute Ralph, who I recently got in touch with to ask if I could use this picture, and he was delighted. And this is one of my slides from last night, talking about the experience of feeling that gays were portrayed as freaks by many of the straight underground cartoonists, and this was disturbing. I recently heard from not this guy, but another cartoonist from that era who wrote me to apologize. He said he sent me a comic strip he had done for one of the undergrounds that sort of portrayed gay people in a dismissive way. And he said that it always, after he had gotten to know me, he really realized that he was embarrassed to have published that, and so he apologized. And, we both live in Massachusetts now and are friends. And I mentioned this last night. A little more detail about this Harold Head strip is very important. It was not just he decided that Harold Head would have a mutual blowjob with another guy. This was specifically protesting this book, Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex But Were Afraid to Ask, which should not be confused with the Woody Allen movie. The Woody Allen bought the rights to essentially the title and the notion of a series of funny pieces about sex. But this book, there's a generation of gay men who feel this book was really damaging. I mean, correctly feel that. It's certainly because it was portrayed as a hip new sex manual was modern and not stuffy like a lot of the old sex manuals. And probably for a lot of the stuff in the book, heterosexual sex, it was probably good, sort of like the joy of sex, you know, something that straight people could feel celebrated sex without guilt. But the section on gays was abominable. It was ignorant. He basically said gay people couldn't love each other, that it was all, I remember a phrase that stuck in my mind. He said for homosexuals, life was a parade of penises. And I was shocked when I saw that this book is still in print, although it has been revised somewhat. But I feel that David Rubin still owes a huge apology to the gay world because of all the young people who felt despair when they read about themselves in this fashion. But good old Rand Holmes, who did the cover for the first issue of Gay Comics, he sort of volunteered as soon as he heard about the project. I can only infer that he was bisexual, although I don't know that. When he was already famous in the underground comics world at the time that he offered to do this, but most of his comics, you know, just had lots of heterosexual buffing in it. And I wrote him a letter, which I could only do indirectly because he was sort of a recluse by that point, but I got Dennis Kitchen to forward it and said, "We're so appreciative of you doing this cover, but you should be aware that, you know, the cover line that will be used with your drawing is lesbians and gay men put it on paper." A lot of people without, you know, any explanation otherwise from you are going to assume you're gay. And I just hope that's okay with you. And, you know, you should know now before we publish it that that's probably going to be the effect. But I never heard from him. And I've heard that from others that wasn't unusual. He was not big on answering letters. But he was forewarned. And, of course, it was a wonderful drawing. Those of you who spent time looking at that cover just know that, I mean, just the craftsmanship was wonderful. The spirit of it was wonderful. Some of the lesbians in the book felt it was, like, rather male-centered. I printed a letter about that in the second issue, a letter to the editor, so that point of view would be have a chance to be voiced. But I think almost everyone agrees it was a great cover. Anyway, that's the Rand Holmes connection. He's been dead now for a number of years, and somebody's doing a biography of him, I understand. And we'll maybe someday we'll know exactly what his story was. And then there's this Pudge Girl blimp, which speaks for itself, and it was already spoken about in a couple of other panels, including my keynote last night. It's just a wonderfully lighthearted look at sort of pansexuality, the desire to, if it feels good, do it, the spirit of the 60s. Lee Marr's portrayed that in a wonderfully comedic way. I mentioned these last night. These are the various forerunners of gay comics, each of which in its own way. Gay Heartthrobs proved you could do it. The lesbians showed how to do it. And Yair Trudeau said, hey, I mean, he didn't say this, but in the spirit, you know, you gays better do it because I'm doing it. And so Andy Lippincott came out in Doonesbury. I think this is, by the way, this last panel, this is masterful. This so encapsulates the straight attitude. If you say you're gay, there must be some authority figures who confirm this. So this was me doing my first overtly gay story, although not quite saying I was gay. I could have been another Gary Trudeau, being a liberal straight guy. I think anybody with any common sense who read that story would say that no straight person would have done this story. But I was still using my Barefoot's characters, which, as you can see, were sort of designed in a way to look like conventional newspaper, comic strip, adorable little characters. And I had these subversive elements in the strip, But around this time, Gravion Gay, my cousin, when she read it, she said, I've never seen such an angry story from Hewitt. The anger didn't fit well into the Barefoots universe. And doing this story sort of made me realize, as important as the Barefoots series has been to me, I'm probably going to have to move beyond it if I want to get into the really gritty reality of not just the gay experience, but politics in general. It's just very hard to feel like you're going to really score important political points if your characters have heads that are as big as the rest of their bodies. And I mentioned this last night. This was my playing around. I think this is I like this Cork and Dork strip for its own sake. I think it's very funny. And at the time, of course, gay marriage was beyond comprehension as something that could actually be accomplished. And I showed the one on the right you saw last night. The one on the left was this I did for the gay newspaper, Gays Week, in New York, shortly after I arrived in New York in 77 and was trying to find a way to be part of the gay movement. I'm not a natural single-panel cartoonist. I'm not good at thinking up single-panel gags. I've done a few. This is one. I put this one in. If I show an example, I show this one because this was one of the half-dozen panel cartoons that I still feel cool about. In general, I feel like I need to have several panels to work through something. And this was a well-meaning but not very inspired political cartoon about the gay march. This was this is just illustrating a temper of the times. The movie and the accompanying book, Word Is Out, which came out in the late 70s, I forget the exact year. It really? As far into the 80s? Okay. All I know is when they made this movie, no one knew about AIDS. This was just about the straight world with the fact that gay people are people. They had a succession of interviews with a lot of gays and lesbians of different temperaments and personalities and backgrounds, and the ultimate thing was to make the point that we are not these shadowy figures to be afraid of, which now, I mean, gosh, it's hard, I'm sure, for young people to realize the degree to which people felt that gay people were people to be afraid of. But a lot of us were dealing with that in our youth, and this helped, and it helped motivate me to want to do cartoons that also delved into the actual real experiences that gay people had to counteract the stereotypes. Oh, there's that Rand Holmes cover. gay comics was not just done out of some impulse to, oh, let's do something gay. It was a response to the incredible homophobia that was building, beyond just the sort of native homophobia of America. There were these anti-gay campaigns like Anita Bryant, who's to this was best known juice commercials, a former Miss America. And she went on her Save Our Children campaign against a gay rights bill that was passed in Dade County, Florida. And it was ultimately repealed after her campaign, and then the shock of the Harvey Milk assassination, which came on the heels of the triumph of the first openly gay elected official. I think that is true. He was certainly a pioneer. He was the first elected official of that level, and I can't imagine there's anybody. Anybody here know if there was an openly gay official before him?
In Boston, Elaine Noble.
Was that before Harvey Milk?
I believe so, yeah.
Well, I didn't remember that. But actually, there had been a drag queen in San Francisco who had run for whatever their term is for city council. And for years, this drag queen ran a gay bar and is talked about, like, is interviewed in the movie Word Is Out, in a very moving sequence in which he talks about this. In his bar, they used to have sort of one-person opera, opera performances by a drag queen. I forget if it was him or just one of the others. But anyway, at the end of this performance in this gay bar in San Francisco, everyone held hands and sang God Bless Us something Queens. What was it?
Nelly Queens.
God Bless Us Nelly Queens. And it's incredibly moving when he tells his story in the movie, and he sort of is weeping as he talks about the spirit of community. And in the book, the Word Is Out book, the interviewers talk about how when they had done the trial, you know, the sort of initial interview, he had also been so moved by describing that moment. And so when they finally put him on film for the final film, you know, all the crew was saying, is he going to cry? Is he going to cry? Because they knew that was dynamite. And he did. And I think if you ever see that movie, you will shed a tear with him because it's terribly moving. But anyway, he tried to do what Harvey Milk ultimately did. But Harvey Milk was a canny politician, and I don't mean that in any negative way. He built a constituency, not just with gay people, but with all sorts of constituencies, underrepresented constituencies in San Francisco. And so it was a real triumph when he was elected, and then an incredible shock when he was assassinated, along with the pro-gay mayor. So anyway, all of this was in the air at the time that we decided we had to put out gay comics and start making strides to tell the world who we are. And is that it? Okay, that was my sort of where I was coming from at the time of the gay comics began.
I actually feature Word Is Out in the Life Capsule Project, and I hadn't revisited that book in many, many decades. It was very influential on, you know, for me. But what I realized recently when I looked at it, it's Word Is Out, and none of the people interviewed use their last names.
Yes. Even Harry Hay, one of the great pioneers of the gay movement, the founder of the homophile... the Mattachine Society, yes. He sort of came from a socialist or communist background, but he essentially was, he broke from that movement because he encountered homophobia in it. And so he started his own progressive organization. This is well before Stonewall. And so he was in the movie, but he was just Harry in the movie, that he was there with his lover. Eddie and I decided to get Word Is Out, I think, from Netflix recently, just to sort of see what it felt like to look at how gays were viewed at that point in history, because the hanging over seeing that movie is the knowledge that we were just on the cusp of the AIDS epidemic and so much would change. And ironically, as tragic as the AIDS epidemic was, I think it did astonishing things in terms of bringing the community together. All of a sudden, you had gay people who previously had been most associated with going out to discos. Now they were associated with being caregivers you know, to their family, keeping their families together, going to memorial services for people they loved. It totally changed the public perception of gay people in a way that I think is one of the early steps toward the kind of appreciation of gay people that resulted in the world we have today, which is better, although not fixed yet.
We have about another 10 minutes for questions, and if you like, you can go to one of the mics so that there are not too many people here, so we can probably hear, but so it'll be picked up on the live stream and the recording.
Is that to me?
Anybody in particular, or just because we're all sort of?
Yeah, I had no problem coming out, except as a gay cartoonist. My family was very accepting. The it just was very easy for me.
Same here.
Yeah.
I was rather paranoid about it at the time. I had some jitters about putting my name in print as a gay artist. There were some eyebrows lifted in certain quarters and other comics fans, and some people tried to make excuses for me. And I didn't hear about any of this directly. I heard about it after the fact, you know, second or third hand years later, but nothing negative at all, really.
When I put out, I was still at Birmingham working at that ad agency when the second issue of Barefoot's Funnies came out with the Gravy on Gay story in it. And I sort of considered the undergrounds were in a whole other universe from my world. But the creative director and my, you know, direct supervisor came in and he said, "Oh, I saw your new comic book today." But he didn't say anything else. And I was in New York, and I found that it was kind of like coming out in the first place. I had all these fears about being rejected by my friends, but I realized after I came out that, in general, the people who are homophobic about you melt away. They don't spend time with you. The people who stay and spend time with you, as a rule, are the ones who accept you, continue to accept you as a friend. That was true in my personal life. And so I'll never know how many art directors might have used me if I wasn't openly gay. But plenty of art directors were not affected, so my career as a freelance mainstream cartoonist continued apace after I came out.
Hi, excuse me, I have two questions. One, I'd like to ask Gerard about the Baseball Hall of Fame. And Rupert, I'm just wondering your reaction to, in the 70s, there were all these blaxploitation films. Did that have any impact on you, Shaft and Superfly and Pam Grier's character?
Okay, the Baseball Hall of Fame thing was, I was asked to do a sketch for a friend of mine who was being inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame as the first ever female ball boy. And they coined the phrase ball dudette for Corinne Mullane, who was in her 70s at the time. So I did a sketch for her. I had worked with her daughter, and Molly had called me and asked me to do that. So I did that for her, and that was brought for the induction to Cooperstown. And afterwards, Corinne wanted to send a thank you to the man who asked her to be part of the museum. And so as a thank you, I did a caricature of him. So that's the second one that's in Cooperstown Hall of Fame. And I had to ask, baseball, is that the one with the stick? Like, what do I know about it? I didn't know anything about the teams or anything. But and Rupert, did you get part of the question? What was it again?
Blaxploitation films.
Yeah, did the blaxploitation films of the 70s have any influence on the characters that you created? Or creating comics at the time?
Yeah, I can't hear you.
Did blaxploitation films of the 70s and 80s have any effects on your reaction with the cartoons?
Well, I certainly would say Superbad, the first character that I created, was absolutely during that time. It was a really good outlet for what was going on in the African American community in terms of being so marginalized in the culture. So, you know, there was that period where it was really all about expressing anger. So, yeah, definitely that the period of having created Superbad was definitely a part of being influenced by the films at that time, definitely.
I want to throw in one addendum to the previous question, talking about careers being damaged. A person now who is largely forgotten, certainly by the young people, but a hero to so many of us was Dave Coppé, the first professional football player to come out. He was not still playing professional football when he came out, and that's, we still have only recently had the experience of professional athletes who are still in the game coming out. But Coppé, it killed his career. I mean, he would have been a coach. Nobody would hire him to coach. He basically had to sell used cars to get by after that. But I don't think I ever read anything to suggest that he regretted coming out, and it was just made such a big impact because gays were viewed as weak, unathletic, which would certainly be true of me, but not about a lot of others.
For the most part, you haven't worked in mainstream comics for companies like Marvel and DC, unless I'm mistaken about that, except for you, Howard, with stuff like that. So I wonder if you're aware of differences in those experiences of being accepted as an openly gay artist in working more in editorial cartooning versus the mainstream comic book industry?
Well, one difference is I don't get invited to comic book conventions. But I've never had anything to do with the mainstream press. I've kind of invented my own little industry, and many of us have.
Right. Everything changed for me after Gay Comics came out in a good way with connection with mainstream comics. I got peer recognition. I think a lot of straight comic book people took me more seriously after that. They could appreciate, as I said, they recognized the honesty factor as being something that had been jacked up in my comics, and I was appreciated more as an artist.
That?
No.
Wondering if you were, what was it? If
it was
working in the mainstream,
did
you have a problem in the mainstream being gay when you were doing all your graphic work?
No, I didn't. The thing is, I've always been committed to working within the alternative press, so I can't really think of any publication I've worked for or where my cartoons have appeared that hasn't been outside of the alternative press. So I really never have done anything in mainstream.
Serious points across by being funny. And I want to know if that is now old-fashioned and being funny is something that doesn't exist anymore. And now you have to bare your soul and be self-exposing rather than telling a joke and getting a funny point and getting a serious point across. So it's not really a question. I just want to know how much of yourself do you have to get a serious point across that belongs to other people rather
I never really wanted to expose myself in these cartoons. I was trying to expose everybody else, and you know, hold up a mirror to the community rather than tell the story about me. That one cartoon in my group that was Chris sitting on the bed telling me to straighten out my closet was the first time that I actually consciously used either one of us in a cartoon. I'm told I look like a lot of the characters in the cartoons, but that was the first time I actually used us in it. And that's the only time I used my personal experience in my cartoons. I'm not one who's going to bare my soul to the world. So don't expect a memoir.
Like any kind of fiction, you use bits and pieces from your own life, you use bits and pieces from other people. The technique is really the same. And I hope that being funny isn't obsolete. But the thing is, you never know when I'm exposing myself and when I'm stealing from somebody else.
I mean, for me, the human comedy is what's interested me. I think even Stuck Rubber Baby, with all its grim parts, has funny moments in it, too. And, you know, I always saw Wendell as, you know, regular life seen through a comedy prism. And Stuck Rubber Baby, you know, was a serious story, but with a recognition of many things in life are funny. And I just don't, I'm not a joke teller. I very rarely do things frame out as jokes in my stuff. Since the earliest days when I was trying to do four-panel comic strips that had a punchline, but I just lost interest in that. But I don't think, there's plenty of my stuff over the years that if it's not funny, it's not for lack of trying. But I want Robert. Robert's at the mic.
Thank you so much. Some of you have works that are, you know, Stuck Rubber Baby, the Wendell Collection, are readily available. But some of you, I'm thinking particularly of your work, Mr. Erichsen, is scattered in a lot of different publishing venues, and I think that's true for all of you at some level. There's no anthology of all the kind of work that you've done. And as someone who teaches literature and queer culture via comics, I'm wondering, is there any interest on your part or on the part of publishers in pulling all your material together and making it available some way like that? Certainly the net would be one way, but also, you know, in print form. Is there any interest? Or is that something that any of you have thought about pursuing or publishers have come to you to pursue?
It's something I have obsessed about. And show me a publisher who's interested and we'll talk. I have tried numerous times to get his gelled. It's kind of scattered.
But you'll also find the collections in No Straight Lines. Strip AIDS, a few books like that we've...
I mean, they're anthologies that do bits and pieces, but right. It's just exactly bits and pieces.
I don't know if anybody's done a real bibliography specifically about LGBT books. That would be an interesting exercise for you academicians out there.
Gerard, Rupert, and Howard have been really generous with their time. Stay in this room for the next panel on creating serialized queer comic strips, and go to 198 for Wonder Woman and Beyond, 201 for This Is What I Look Like, Creating Queer Characters of Color, 202 for The Evolution of Humor in Queer Comics with Kurt, and 203 for Trans Visibility in Imagined Worlds. Thanks again.